definitely a website that you want to check out here. And huntersportspicks.com is still going. Kyle's still with premium subscriptions and whatnot over there. And a lot of college basketball stuff going on over there right now, Kyle. And again, obviously, the bowl season, you know, a little bit of a break here for us all in college football, but that'll change here beginning Friday and Saturday. College basketball will not. In fact, it amps up in a big way on Saturday. Huge card, lots of big non-conference games, a lot of low major conferences in action here tonight on Monday. So not a whole lot for us to talk about early on in the week, but there are a few injuries that you did want to bring to light here how to kick off today's segment.
Yeah, I'll start with Seton Hall. I think, you know, what has it been? Every week we talk about Seton Hall at some point, I think. Miles Powell sustained a concussion in the first half against Rutgers. You know, this team's really been snake bit so far as far as injuries. I'm really upset with myself for not taking Rutgers in that game against Seton Hall. It was one of my strong leans that, you know, on Saturday I had a really miserable day in college basketball. And I'm always honest about this. I've been really running bad here in college basketball of late. You know, a lot of my strong leans have done well that I didn't end up playing, and the plays, you know, have suffered some pretty bad beats, but it's a long season ahead. And I'll just say that, you know, that's one of those where it is, though, easy after the fact to say, well, Rutgers won pretty easily in that game, but Miles Powell missed most of the game, and he didn't know that was going to happen. It would be a lot easier to take Rutgers. But Miles Powell, if he's going to be out for any kind of extended time, Seton Hall really doesn't have much at all. I mean, he was everything after Mamukelashvili or Mamukelashvili was out there with his injury. And, you know, Seton Hall doesn't have enough offense. They'll scrap around. They'll use that press defense to try to create some turnovers. But in the half court, how are they going to score? I think Seton Hall, a team that is unbettable without Miles Powell.
I'll throw out another one here that he's been out for a long time, but I just noticed this, and shame on me. I mean, you know, it was tough because this was early November. I was doing so much with college football and the NFL, obviously, here on a daily basis with the show. But I noticed that for Valparaiso, Ryan Fizikas is out again, and he's been out for a long time. And they've actually struggled more on the defensive end this season. I wrote up a preview of tonight's Valpo and Charlotte game over at bangthebook.com, but that was one where I'm kind of looking at Valpo and I'm like, what's up with this team? You know, they're not really performing up to expectation again here. Come to find out Fizikas is hurt. They got a sophomore in Freeman Liberty. Great name, by the way, doing everything for them here so far this season. But that's the thing, man. You know, you've got to try and really dig. And sometimes it's hard to find that news, hard to find that information. Something like Miles Powell is a big deal. Something like Cole Anthony that we'll talk about here in a few minutes. Everybody knows about that one. It's a big deal, but man, these low and mid-major ones, you got to try and find them and exploit them as much as you can.
Yeah, I have to tell you, college basketball is far, far more difficult to find injuries than college football. There's so many more teams, obviously. And until you get to January and February, especially February and March, a lot of people aren't paying too much attention to college basketball. And I'm sure that's something that we'll talk about after bowl season's over, is that, you know, there's a lot of people that don't bet college basketball until after all of college football's over. And then some people that don't bet it at all until after the NFL's over and they want to get ready for March Madness. But these lower teams like Valparaiso, it's very hard to find injury information. Valpo has been really pushing the pace this year. They're 51st in average possession length. Last year they were 304. So they're trying to play very fast, but they're without what I would say is their best shot maker, Ryan Fizikas. So it's not gone great for them. You know, they're 6-4. They're a team that's used to winning quite a bit. The Missouri Valley Conference is a pretty strong conference. So as long as Fizikas is out, and he's been very injury prone, I think Valpo could probably struggle there in the MVC.
Now there is another injury. Again, we'll work the Cole Anthony one in a little bit more as we talk about North Carolina making the trip up to take on Gonzaga later on in the week. But there is another one that you wanted to mention here over at St. John's.
Yeah, Mustafa Heron sprained his ankle. They thought it might be worse than this when he first got injured. He's questionable for this week's games. I think he's the most important player to his team. I think he'll probably play based on what I've read so far, but I think that's one that you definitely want to pay attention to. St. John's pressing, you know, the 40 minutes of hell defense. This is a St. John's team that really needs to be able to create those steals and score quickly. They're not very good in the half court offense. Heron is a good offensive player. He's very quick. has a good long range shot. I don't think they can afford to have him not on the floor. So St. John's a team that I wouldn't want to bet unless I knew he was playing.
Yeah, it definitely makes sense. And, you know, as we take a look here at the schedule for this week, like I said, I mean, things kind of amp up a little bit later on in the week. I did my situational betting article over at bangthebook.com. Lots of in-state stuff. Delaware State, Delaware tonight. North Florida, Florida State tomorrow. Denver, Northern Colorado also tomorrow. You've got Seattle taking on Washington. These little brother, big brother games here on the holidays. Maybe some of these, you know, big brother teams have been playing some of these premier non-conference games, step down in class, take a few punches from some of these lower tier teams. You know, some of those lower tier teams getting big spreads may be able to cover some of those numbers. I think Tuesday, a game we can touch on real quickly here, Kyle. Florida and Providence is interesting to me because this one in Brooklyn, Basketball Hall of Fame Invitational, these have been two disappointing teams so far that, you know, I think that both of these teams should be highly invested, highly motivated to get something of a nice win because they haven't found too many of them.
You know, Florida's had a long break here too. They played Butler and lost 76-62. Now they go all the way from December 7th to the 17th without playing.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that's what I was going to say. I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. I will say I can't believe Florida's not been any better than they are. That's a team that I had pegged wrong before the season. I thought they were going to be really good. As I mentioned before, I think it's a little surprising that Florida continues to play so slowly with the talent and athleticism that they have. You would think they would want to get up and down the court. You know, this is a neutral site game in Brooklyn. So, you know, whether you think that that's a good thing for Providence since they're a little bit closer, probably is, but I don't think that'd make a big difference. Providence has been a big disappointment too. And we've talked about them, you know, a couple weeks ago, we mentioned Rhode Island as being a good play. That ended up working out well. And then this past weekend, fortunately, worked out well too for Northern Colorado over Wyoming. So hopefully listeners have been able to cash into those plays. Providence has still been very weak. I mean, they won by four against Stony Brook this past Saturday. Stony Brook's not a bad team, but Providence has got to win by more than a four-point margin against them. So even though Florida has not played well this year, I think I would lean to Florida in this game. Florida will probably be laying 4 or 4.5 points. I don't know that I really want to lay the points. I mean, to be honest with you, maybe the under is a better play if Florida continues to play slowly, but you kind of picked out a game that I would say I don't really want to bet here.
No, that's fair. I mean, I'm looking at Providence. I mean, it's largely the same team from last year. They're good on the offensive glass. They're good at forcing turnovers. They're 11th in the country in turnover percentage on defense. And yet, they lose to Northwestern on the road. They lose to Penn at home, lose to Long Beach State and College of Charleston in one of those Thanksgiving tournaments, the Rhode Island blowout. Sometimes you just kind of wonder, like, what it is about these teams. They have so much talent. I think Ed Cooley is a pretty good coach. This is a team that's probably going to be dangerous in the Big East tournament, as they always are, but there's just some sort of disconnect here, and it's always interesting to try and read into those and try and figure out kind of, you know, where those are and what the reasons are early on in the season. A team like Cincinnati, on the other hand, they host Tennessee coming up here on Wednesday. We know what the problems are with them. Going from Mick Cronin to John Brannan, different style of play. Are they in trouble here against our friend Rick Barnes in Tennessee in the Queen City on Wednesday?
I wouldn't want to bet Cincinnati here. You know, obviously, Tennessee with a disappointing performance there in that last game at home against Memphis, you would think that Tennessee would be up for this game. I think I would lean to Tennessee in this one. And the way Cincinnati lost at the end of the game the other night, if you haven't watched the end of the game, Cincinnati and Colgate, you need to watch the end of that game. It was absolutely wild. Tie game with about 5 seconds left. And Jaron Cumberland takes a shot from behind half court with 5 seconds left. Colgate gets the defensive rebound. And with 1 second left, Cincinnati fouls them and they make a free throw. So Cincinnati basically had the last shot. They were either going to win or go to overtime. They ended up losing in regulation, which is difficult to do, but they were able to do that. So Cincinnati has really had some significant problems. Even in some of their wins, really been very good. They needed overtime to beat Valpo and UNLV, teams that, you know, they have a lot more talent than those two teams. So I think Cincinnati's a team that I would be looking to fade until they give us reasons to think otherwise.
Well, and then it gets me to start thinking here a little bit about the futures market for the NCAA tournament. If Cincinnati is not going to be that great, and it certainly looks that way, and obviously Brandon did very well at Northern Kentucky, he could turn this thing around. But it gets me to start thinking about futures out of the AAC. You know, Memphis is the team that everyone kind of talks about for, you know, obvious reasons. But, you know, maybe you start looking at taking a long shot Wichita State position or, you know, Houston with Kelvin Sampson, something like that. Because if Cincinnati is not going to be the team here, you start thinking ahead to March and maybe you find yourself some opportunities.
Yeah, the one I would have said is Wichita State, the first one that you mentioned. I think they've been really impressive so far this year, especially with a team that's not experienced at all. You know, this is a team that won big at Oklahoma State and then followed it up by beating Oklahoma at home. Some pretty good wins there for them. They blew out South Carolina on a neutral. Their only loss was to West Virginia. Obviously, they haven't played a great schedule so far, but I agree with you. You know, Cincinnati's usually been one of those top teams in that conference. And unless something changes, it looks like they aren't going to be on that same level this year.
All right, so we take a little bit of a jump. Well, actually, I guess we stay here on Wednesday night, but we take a massive jump across the country. North Carolina and Gonzaga. Credit to the Tar Heels for scheduling this game, for going up to Spokane to take on the Bulldogs. The problem is North Carolina, not the same team as they've always been. And as we teased already, no Cole Anthony in this one.
Yeah, and I want to say a stat here about Cole Anthony. It's unbelievable how much he's meant to this team. North Carolina with Cole Anthony on the floor this year, 0.94 points per possession. Without him, 0.85 points per possession. And on defense, they're giving up 0.85 points per possession with him on the floor, and they're allowing 1.02 points per possession without him on the floor. So this is a massive loss. I mean, that splits this deep into the season that you almost never see. So North Carolina, significant loss for them. There's no way I could bet North Carolina in this game or any game anytime soon. The only way I could look at this game is Gonzaga. Obviously, North Carolina coming off that loss to Wofford. You know, Wofford's coach joking after the game, they're not going to schedule us ever again, you know, that type of thing. Maybe they won't, but North Carolina going all the way to Gonzaga. Gonzaga has really impressed me so far this year. If you look at Gonzaga, they had that impressive win against Washington on the road. And you think, man, this is a difficult spot for them playing at Arizona. After that, after coming off the big win against Washington in a game where, you know, obviously that game means a lot to them with the proximity of those two teams. Then they go down to Arizona and win 84-80. Maybe Arizona is not quite as good as we thought, but Gonzaga has some really good wins this year. Oregon on a neutral, at Washington, at Arizona. Gonzaga, you know, is going to be laying double digits in this game, I would think, without Cole Anthony. So I don't know if I want to lay double digits here, but it would be either Gonzaga, ATS, or the under here for me. I think that North Carolina will have a lot of trouble scoring here.
Well, you know, like we mentioned about Cincinnati, coming off of that Xavier game, we know what the crosstown shootout means for those two teams. Not just, I mean, yeah, they lost to Colgate, which obviously looks really bad, but they were also nowhere close to covering that game. Gonzaga here this week, North Carolina on Wednesday. They're going to be over a 20-point favorite against Eastern Washington on Saturday. So you play, of your last six games, Oregon, Michigan, Texas Southern, Washington, Arizona, North Carolina. Then you play Eastern Washington in a massive favorite role. Might be looking to take the Eagles there in one of those little brother, big brother games on Saturday.
Yeah, I agree with you. I like the look ahead spots that we talk about because, you know, you play that kind of schedule and there's got to be some kind of letdown. And you would think that that would be the game where that would happen.
Now, I know that there was a game that you wanted to mention here over the course of the week. We like to go under the radar, obviously, and talk about a lot of different games. What was the one that you wanted to mention here? UNC Greensboro in a big game that they've got here this week.
Yeah, this is partially because of a situational spot and partially just because I like to talk about some of these mid-majors. And I promise you, as we go deeper into the season and college basketball, we'll talk about plenty of these teams that you're not going to hear anything about anywhere else. You know, nobody likes to talk about those way under the radar games any more than I do. And we've covered those quite a bit over the years. UNC Greensboro just lost on Sunday the 15th here to NC State at home, 80-77. That was a huge game for that program. I know they put everything into that game. You know, Greensboro makes a big run late, almost pulls it off, but they trailed most of that game. They were down by 13 with 10 minutes left, came back, lost by 3 points. Now they go to Vermont here on Wednesday. Vermont has had a long break. As I've said before, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. They played the 7th, and then they're off all the way till the 18th. You know, I think if Vermont's losing or tied or something at halftime, this is a really good spot to take Vermont in the second half. I like Vermont some full game. I don't know how they'll play in the first half based on that layoff, but I like them to win this game. I think that Vermont has easily the best player on the floor. Anthony Lamb is very, very good. He's taking a high percentage of their shots. He's involved in everything for them. And this is a guy that's going to play in the NBA. Anthony Lamb is a very good player. Nobody on UNC Greensboro's roster can match up with him. Greensboro has played the 302nd toughest schedule so far this year. Vermont has played the 65th toughest schedule. So Vermont has played much tougher teams. UNC Greensboro coming off a tough loss. I like Vermont here. And like I said, I like Vermont second half better even than full game.
It's not even just that UNC Greensboro lost. It was a shot from half court that was the game winner there in that one for NC State. So doubly bad beat for Greensboro there in that one. And again, you don't go up to Vermont a whole lot. You know, I mean, a lot of Greensboro's games, a lot of regional stuff, because there's a lot of good programs around there that they can play, stuff like that. You don't go to Vermont too often. So long travel trip, you know, who knows, there could be weather up there that could delay, you know, flights and buses and everything else. So a very difficult spot there for the Spartans coming up that game on Wednesday night as well. Real quickly, looking ahead to Saturday, I just want to ask you about this. Indiana versus Notre Dame, Purdue versus Butler. These games at Bankers Life Fieldhouse in Indianapolis. And man, I love this. This is awesome to see the Hoosier State doing this with, you know, four really legit programs in that state playing these neutral site games with what should be very spirited crowds in Indianapolis.
Yeah, I like this a lot too. Utah did that there this past weekend. BYU, Utah State, Weber, Utah, those games. I like the ones that do this. You know, this isn't very common anymore is what I'm trying to say. You know, a lot of teams in the past, this was very common. It hasn't been here lately. Indiana, to me, I thought maybe they were back, and then the very next game they get blown out by Wisconsin in a terrible, terrible showing there. They win against UConn on a neutral, and then they beat Nebraska at home in overtime, which certainly is not very impressive. So Indiana, a team to me that I guess, you know, a bit of an unknown, especially this deep into the season. Indiana's defense was supposed to be their calling card under Miller. Indiana has not been good on defense this year, 138th in effective field goal percentage defense. So to me, that surprises me quite a bit. Notre Dame, a team that I don't think has really been that consistently good either. If you take a look at these teams, I feel like there's quite a bit of unknown with several of these teams. Butler is the team that's been the most consistent here from this state. Butler's 10-1. They had that 1-point loss to Baylor on the road. Certainly not a bad loss at all there. And Butler wasn't rated that highly before the season. You got a Purdue team that's 6-4. Purdue has some good wins. They beat VCU on a neutral, a pretty good win. A tight loss to Florida State on a neutral. A 29-point win against Virginia. I don't think Virginia is as good as some people think they are this year. And then a 14-point loss here on Sunday night against Nebraska on the road. So Purdue, again, a big question mark to me. I would probably lean Butler in that game, to be honest, and also would lean to the under, but the total will be pretty low there, probably low 120s.
One last game to mention here for Saturday. I just want to get your take on this one. Ohio State and Kentucky out in Las Vegas at T-Mobile Arena. Something interesting about this game situationally is that Kentucky plays Utah in Las Vegas. I believe that game is either Wednesday or Thursday. Ohio State plays Kentucky in Vegas on Saturday. So Kentucky will have already played a game there. Ohio State making the trip out there for Saturday's contest. The Buckeyes have looked great when they've played these premier teams. Are they able to do it again here?
Yeah, Ohio State had played really well, and they might have gone to number one, but then they lost to Minnesota there on Sunday. Dwayne Washington didn't play in that game, and he's been pretty good for them. He's questionable for this one. I think he makes a difference for that team. Kentucky has been disappointing so far this year, especially on offense. I think Kentucky's defense is pretty good. They're 8th in defensive efficiency, 11th in effective field goal percentage defense. Ohio State's 4th in efficient defensive efficiency and 5th in effective field goal percentage defense. They were really bad on defense against Minnesota. I don't think they'll be bad on defense again here. My lean in this game is the under. I think this could be a tight, low-scoring game here. Ohio State and Kentucky. Ohio State's not as good as they looked here early in the season. And also, you know, that win against North Carolina on the road, maybe that wasn't quite as good a win as we thought. The 25-point win over Villanova at home is certainly impressive. The win over Cincinnati, also not as impressive as some would have thought at the beginning of the season. I think Ohio State's a very good team. I don't know if they're an elite team. I hope so as a Buckeyes fan, obviously. Kentucky, a team that's been disappointing so far this year, but they certainly have the talent and the length and athleticism. I like the under in this game. I think if you get a number, you know, 133 or 134, I think that'd be a good look to the under.
Kyle Hunter, professional handicapper over at huntersportspicks.com. We already mentioned the free bowl content over at bettersportspicks.com. So what's going over at huntersportspicks.com right now?
Yeah, sign up for the free picks newsletter if you haven't already. They're at huntersportspicks.com. I'll be lowering my prices here and putting out a bowl package here later today, all-access bowl package that's going to be $270 for all plays through bowl season. There'll be a decent amount of plays there, not a huge amount of volume, but a decent amount of plays, and that'll certainly be a savings over paying for every play individually. So check that out. And as we mentioned earlier, I'll mention again one more time, the bettersportspicks.com website where you can check out free information and go to that free members area there and register for the free area. I'll be doing some contests for prizes there, cash prizes coming up here in the next couple weeks as well.
Well, of course, make sure you follow Kyle on Twitter at Kyle Hunter Picks. Kyle Hunter, huntersportspicks.com as well as bettersportspicks.com. Appreciate your time as always, man. Thank you so much for joining me. We'll talk to you again next week.
Thanks, man. Take care.